President Trump's phase one trade deal with China is largely a win for Beijing. Just measure the agreement signed this week against the initial demands made by Washington in a May 2018 document that Beijing promptly leaked. As the Financial Times concludes, with regard to the central U.S. goals, after almost 2 years of negotiations, tariffs, and counter-tariffs, Mr. Trump has achieved none of these objectives. This outcome is partly a reflection of the two sides' staying power. China is a one-party state that can take the long view. Trump had gambled that he could hurt the Chinese economy enough with the imposition of tariffs that the pain to American consumers who actually paid for those tariffs would be worth it. But eventually, the president apparently decided that he wanted to smooth the economic waters as he runs for re-election. So he folded. From a broader perspective, however, this trade deal reflects something new on the international landscape, something the United States is going to have to grapple with for decades. As I argue in an essay in Foreign Affairs, China is the first real peer competitor that the United States has faced in the modern era. Even the Soviet Union was never really an economic peer. China, after all, is the world's second largest economy. In fact, by some measures, it is the largest. It is the largest trading partner of most countries in Asia and many around the globe. It holds the world's largest foreign exchange reserves, and it leads the globe in many industries, including high-tech sectors like 5G. Perhaps more significantly, it is not part of the American security system. You see, Washington has faced an extraordinarily benign international environment in one key respect. After World War II, the countries that emerged or re-emerged to wealth and power were all, to put it bluntly, American protectorates. Germany, France, Britain, Japan, South Korea. China is most decidedly not in that group. Add to this a very different political system and cultural background, as well as a desire to project power in Asia and beyond, and you have the makings of a complex relationship that is perhaps destined for some degree of conflict. But as Trump's failed negotiations demonstrate, this is not a case where threats, confrontation, and bluster will always work. China, too, has leverage. And on China, the fault does not lie solely with Trump. Democrats have turned equally hawkish on China and protectionist in general. Trump's deal is being criticized by all the leading lights of the party, but had a Democrat been in the White House, the outcome probably would not have been very different. The geopolitical threat of a rising China is poorly understood, often prompting knee-jerk references to another Cold War. A comparison might help. Forget the Soviet Union and just look at Russia today as it tries to degrade, even destroy, the open international order that the West has forged since 1945. China has actually been trying to grow rich and powerful within that order. China is not a rogue nation like Russia, seeking to interfere in Western democracy and invade its neighbors. As I noted in Foreign Affairs, China under Mao used to be a leading sponsor of revolutionary insurgencies across the planet. It is now the second largest funder of UN peacekeeping. In fact, Beijing has not gone to war since 1979, a record of non-intervention that makes it unique among the permanent members of the UN Security Council. America is going to compete with China for the bulk of the 21st century. But it will have to do so wisely, enlisting allies and trying to keep the competition within the international system. If instead we go down a path of confrontation and containment, China is now powerful enough that this struggle would destroy the open international order and the open global economy. We would end up with government controls on trade, technology, and travel, a ceaseless struggle for allies and influence around the world, lower levels of economic growth, and the dangers of a nuclear arms race and even war. With China, the challenge is not how tough you can be, but how smart. For more, go to cnn.com/Fareed and read my Washington Post column this week.